conducted this research as part of my Master of Science in Applied Animal Behavior and Animal Welfare at the University of Edinburgh. It was my dissertation project. And I conducted the research at the Project Parry, the Central Virginia Parrot Sanctuary, which is in rural Louisa County, Virginia. And it's in a secluded area with woods surrounding the land. They have a large African gray aviary, which you see pictured, and that was the focus of my study. It has a nice outdoor portion and a covered indoor section. The indoor section was the focus of my research. It was climate controlled, so it was a consistent temperature of 70 degrees Fahrenheit, and it is 30 feet wide by 50 feet deep. The entire aviary structure is 3,600 square feet. The sanctuary is not open to visitors except during their open house on May 6th, once a year. And I was lucky to be able to observe the behavior of a group of parrots in the sanctuary setting. There were 47 African grays in this aviary during my study. They were males and females, Congos and Timnas. And they had been rescued from various different backgrounds. Some were from hoarding cases or abuse cases. Approximately half were wild caught and the other half were captive bred. They were all adults and they had all lived in the aviary for over 6 months before my study. And you can see those orange tables. They are the food tables, which had food placed on them and water placed on them in a tray every morning so that the parrots had free access to food, fruits, vegetables, and different pellets. I'll also have you notice the floor, the ground level is natural dirt, and it also has worms that were added to the soil. The sanctuary director ordered and added red worms to the soil so that the worms digest the waste from the parrots. And the sanctuary staff will occasionally rake and turn over the waste so that it goes into the soil to be digested by the worms. It's a nice system. And there's also a thin layer of mulch, which is covering the floor. It was added in 2009 when this aviary opened and has remained in the same area of the floor for 7 years prior to my study. I sat here in this doorway looking into the indoor section of the aviary when I did my observations. I did preliminary observations during the summer of 2015 and again in March 2016, which allowed the birds to get used to me coming into their aviary and get familiar with seeing me. It also allowed me to identify individual parrots. I wasn't able to mark the birds, but I could see little details and markings that were naturally on the birds, and that allowed me to identify individuals. For example, there's this red spot of three red feathers on Elvis's neck, and there's a bald patch on the back of Rue's neck. It also allowed me time to observe behaviors and to consult with sanctuary staff and the director to make sure that my research was designed in a way that wouldn't cause any disruption to the parrots or to the sanctuary staff's procedures. And you can see in this video, I was surprised to see that even though these parrots are all fully flighted, they can all fly, but some were choosing to spend time on the ground. And when they're on the ground, they would often be doing this, which is chewing pieces of mulch. And sometimes they would just chew the pieces of mulch, as you see this Timna doing in the video. Sometimes they would pick up a mulch piece with their foot and then hold it and manipulate it with their zygodactyl feet and play with it almost as if it were a toy. I was also interested to see the hole digging behavior of the parrots. These parrots would dig holes in the floor of the sanctuary. So you can see that the parrots are digging holes here, and there are quite a few holes that had previously been dug. So I used my observations to create behavioral ethograms where I defined the behaviors that I saw. This is an example of my social behavior ethogram, and it has affiliative and agonistic behaviors. I also had a foraging behavior ethogram and had inactive behaviors as well. And in this video, you can see some social behavior. The parrot walking here is Johnny. He has a white head. It's His head is bald, so it looks white. He's missing all his head feathers. And then you can see he's being chased by Stormy. Stormy chases him, and there's an aggressive interaction. That's a high level of aggression. Stormy's mate, Chuck-Chuck, joins him, and the mated pair chase Johnny away together. They're chasing Johnny away from their territory. And usually I didn't see that high level of aggression. I mainly saw more subtle aggression that was just walking. So Johnny is walking away from Chuck and Stormy as he flees. Chuck-Chuck and Stormy are now walking toward Johnny, chasing him away. And Johnny is walking far out of his way, staying on the ground, but walking around the edge of the floor to slowly get to the area where he's headed. And he's actually headed into his own territory. You can also see in the background there are parrots. There's a parrot digging a hole, and there's a parrot chewing mulch. And now Johnny's back to his territory, which is that bush. And you can see his mate, June, is walking down the diagonal perch. The first phase of my study was the baseline phase. It was in March 2016. I focused on the ground level of the aviary, so I divided it into 12 different zones. And I used those zones to record the locations of the parrots. I did an instantaneous scan sample every 2 minutes, so I sat and looked at the entire aviary floor and recorded the locations, behaviors, and names of any parrots that were on the ground. And I did that during 7 days. I used, for example, here's zone F1, and this is what zone F1 looks like in the aviary. And you can see there's this metal pole. There were evenly spaced metal poles that were supporting the roof of the aviary, and they, I could use them to delineate the ends of each zone. So I used that data that I collected to create this baseline territory map. It is color-coded. The individual parrots or mated pairs who spent a lot of time together were given their own color. The green area is just an area that had very few observations. It was either low visibility or low use. There's a lot of vegetation there. And the gray area is between the two food tables, and you'll see lots of different colored dots because a lot of different individuals shared that space. All the other colors represent observations of parrots in those locations. So each dot is a single observation, each fully colored square is 25 or more observations in that location of that individual, and the slash lines are 10 or more observations. So you can see that there are territories at the ground level of the aviary, and I encircled the territories with those black lines just to estimate their shape. And then the next phase of my study was an experimental enrichment phase. I created an enrichment device using a stainless steel metal tray. I used stainless steel because it's indestructible and non-toxic, so I could use it repeatedly without the parrots destroying it. And I also filled that with pine bark mulch chips. And these pine bark mulch chips were brand new. The chips you can see are a different color than the older chips, even though they're the exact same type that had already been in the aviary. And they are slightly bigger because the parrots have not yet chewed them. And the mulch is deeper in the tray because, you know, it's a deep tray, so there's a little bit of a deep litter experiment going on. And I used this territory map from the baseline to plan where I would place the tray. I wanted to look at the interplay between the social structure, social dynamics, and territories, and enrichment. So how do territories affect access to enrichment, and does providing enrichment change parrot social structure? And I had this one aviary, so my sample size was one, and so I used randomization statistical tests to do my analysis. So I randomized the length of the observations, the time of the observations, and the location of the tray. So there's a gray rectangle which represents each place where the tray was located. and there was sort of a control. I had the tray in the shared area as well as in separate territories. Anecdotally, it seemed that more birds spent time, more birds did spend time at the tray in the shared space, but that was not statistically significantly different than in the territories. So for the enrichment phase, I did a focal scan of the zone that contained the tray every 2 minutes, just looking at that zone, recording the behaviors and names of the parrots interacting with the tray. And then I scanned the entire aviary floor every 10 minutes to record the locations of the birds across the floor. Here's a video of enrichment in action. This is George, who is standing on the edge of the tray right now. He's chewing a piece of mulch. And now Evelyn is starting to climb onto the corner. And this is in zone B1, which is George's territory. But Evelyn and Clyde, the mated pair, have come into his territory to interact with the tray. Evelyn's chewing on mulch now. And her mate Clyde is walking around the edge, and then he starts to chase George out of the tray. And the mated pair chase George away. And there was this back and forth social territoriality around the enrichment device, with George fleeing and then approaching again. And Evelyn chases him away by walking across the edge. But later he did return to interact with the tray again. So my results, I found that George performed more inactive behavior during the baseline before I added the enrichment. He was sleeping, self-grooming, and standing still more frequently before the enrichment was added. He was from a neglect case and showed some depressed behavior. And then during the enrichment phase, he was much more active, and that was statistically significant. He was interacting with the tray and performing foraging and social behavior. However, he was the only individual for whom I found a significant effect of the enrichment device. The enrichment device did increase digging and mulch chewing behavior of George, Evelyn, and Clyde significantly, but it did not increase the activity and foraging behavior of the entire group of parrots. The enrichment device had a local effect. It changed the size of two territories in one floor quadrant, so Evelyn and Clyde's territory actually extended into George's, but it didn't really affect the sizes of other territories. The birds performed behaviors on the ground. Approximately, or nearly half of the total birds were seen on the ground, so I recorded 23 individual parrots on the ground during my study out of the 47 birds that lived in the aviary. And they performed various behaviors, foraging and social behaviors on the ground. They also did a lot of standing, perching behavior, but out of the active behaviors, digging, walking, and mulch chewing were the top three. And then they were followed by other foraging and social and play behaviors. So why do parrots dig? Interestingly, the enrichment tray elicited digging because when I put the tray on the ground, parrots came towards the tray and dug at the edge of the metal where it was on top of the dirt. So they would dig a little cavity out as if the bottom of the tray were creating a roof for a little cave that they were digging. And they also dug in the mulch inside the tray, always with their heads facing down into a corner of the tray and kicking mulch behind their bodies. Usually parrots would dig with a mate if they were in a mated pair, so mates would take turns digging the same hole, and one mate would stand and watch while the other parrot dug, which makes me think that it's a nesting behavior. Perhaps African greys are able to excavate their nest sites. they nest in holes in trees, but maybe they can change the size of those holes by digging. They also eat roots in the wild, so maybe they dig to get to roots. And there could be other explanations, like geophagy, which is eating soil. Why did they chew mulch? I think that, well, I know that parrots in the wild eat pine bark, or eat mulch, sorry. Parrots in the wild eat bark, and bark may have a nutritional benefit for parrots. So perhaps they are eating the pine bark mulch because bark provides some nutrition for African greys. It's also been found that wild parrots use small pieces of bark to line their nest sites. So they'll put a few pieces of bark in the bottom of their nest. Finally, mulch chewing could be related to this theory that destructible, manipulable objects can be foraging substitutes for captive parrots. These parrots did not have access to nuts with their shells on to crack. They also didn't have large fruit with large seeds to tear open, and they have highly evolved beaks that can perform many cracking and manipulation behaviors. So it's possible that since they didn't have these nuts to crack, they were redirecting the cracking behavior onto the pieces of mulch, which would fit with this foraging substitute theory. So it's good to have items that they can destroy and chew if they, you know, don't have access to nuts. The reason they didn't have nuts was because the shells were making too much of a mess in the aviary, so they chose to discontinue giving those to them before my study started. So the territory maps didn't change greatly. Their territories were quite stable over time. But there is a change in the size of Evelyn and Clyde's territory, and it extended into George's. And I did do social network analysis. This is the baseline map. Each node represents an individual parrot. They're color-coded in the same way that the territory map was color-coded by individual or mated pair. The lines show parrots who are in close proximity to each other. Dashed lines are parrots who were only in close proximity, and solid lines are parrots who also mated or locked beaks with each other or groomed each other, so they can be thought of as mated pairs. There are more parrots on the ground during the baseline than during the experimental phase. So fewer parrots were on the ground while the enrichment device was there, but one individual, Stormy, became more socially connected during the enrichment phase. He was interacting socially with more different parrots because the enrichment device was present. In conclusion, greys perform many behaviors on the ground. Space use follows a pattern which relates to the social structure, and mated pairs have small territories. The enrichment device did not provide enrichment for all of the birds in the aviary, only a few benefited. I recommend providing enrichment items in all territories to prevent distress and to increase resource access. There are conservation applications. Wild parrots are territorial around their nest sites, so they won't use every available hollow in a tree that could be used for nesting because they want to nest away from their conspecifics. So it's important if we're putting nest boxes in nature to help offset the problems with deforestation and habitat destruction that these parrots face in the wild, that we space them appropriately. Also, this digging behavior could mean that these greys are a little more resilient than we thought and may be able to nest in more different environments because they can excavate the nest site. However, they never laid eggs in this aviary. They also didn't have nest boxes in the aviary. When we are housing parrots before releasing them back into the wild, we should allow them the opportunity to practice their natural behaviors that will help them survive in the wild. If digging is important, we should allow them access to a substrate in which to dig. And we should do more scientific research to provide evidence-based approaches to enrichment, which will aid conservation and promote animal welfare. Thank you.